Welcome back to another episode of What's in the Night Sky, sponsored by Squarespace. And it is August 2021. I'm sure those of us in the Northern Hemisphere, mid to high latitudes, are welcoming the lengthening nights and the return of darkness. But coming up this month, we have one of the best meteor showers of the year, the Perseid meteor shower. Saturn reaches opposition, so it'll be shining at its brightest. Jupiter also reaches opposition. We have a blue moon, and of course plenty of Milky Way core action. But before we deep dive into all of that and more, a quick message from the sponsors of today's video, Squarespace. Squarespace is the place to host a website or an online store, and I speak from personal experience because my website is hosted on Squarespace and I've been a happy customer for years now. I use it to advertise and sell my workshops. I also use it to sell my Astro Workflow Lightroom presets, and Squarespace takes care of the payments and everything is hosted there, and it means that I can spend more of my time taking photographs and editing them. And then I can upload them to the galleries on my website in full quality. Your images don't get compressed like they do on social media like Facebook and Instagram. They get uploaded at 100% quality. If you'd like to give Squarespace a try, head on over to squarespace.com/Alan. You can start your free trial. You can start with one of their award-winning templates. You can edit that template to your heart's content to really make it your own website. And then once you're ready to go live, use the code ALAN and get 10% off your first purchase of a website or a domain name with Squarespace. Starting in the Northern Hemisphere and facing north towards the circumpolar constellations, you'll notice Ursa Major sinking down to the horizon, the north-northwest horizon, and coming into its more upright position, which for me is my favorite position of Ursa Major. You can get a nice foreground there with Ursa Major nice and low on the horizon. So this here is an image that I took in Madeira just last week. You can see Ursa Major nice and low on the horizon, using the star glow filter to make the constellation pop a little bit better. And it's just my favorite orientation for Ursa Major. Facing west in the evening skies after sunset, you'll notice a trio of planets. So you have Mercury, Mars, and Venus. Mercury and Mars, very hard to observe from the Northern Hemisphere unless you're sort of close to the equator, latitudes close to the equator, because they're very close to the Sun. But if I skip forward a few days to the 18th of August, you'll see a real nice conjunction between Mars and Mercury in the evening skies. But zooming out, you'll see Mercury and Mars set in very shortly after the Sun. Then as darkness falls, it's a lot easier to observe Venus, and of course Venus being the brightest object in the night sky after the Moon. Facing south, as darkness falls, you'll notice the Milky Way core starts the night in the south, now very high in the sky, and it's a really good time to photograph it, so make the most of it whilst you can, because it starts to sink down to the southwest. Milky Way core is being chased across the sky by Saturn and Jupiter, both shining their brightest this month. Saturn reaches opposition on the 2nd of August, and Jupiter reaches opposition on the 19th of August. And when a planet reaches opposition, it is directly opposite the Sun for those of us on Earth. So not only is it the closest we get to that planet, but it's also fully illuminated by the Sun, which is why they shine at their brightest. Now, facing east in the evening skies, if I just zoom in, you'll see Andromeda, the spiral galaxy. And that starts in the night pretty high in the east, and as the night goes on, it just gets higher and higher into the eastern sky. So Andromeda really making a return to the night sky. And as we approach the pre-dawn hours, you'll also notice the likes of Pleiades rising into the east, Hyades as well around the star Aldebaran in Taurus. So there are signs of the winter constellations returning. So make the most of the Milky Way core while you can, because we're entering that transition period now between the summer and winter constellations. Onto the Southern Hemisphere, and as darkness falls, you'll find the small and large Magellanic clouds very low on the horizon. So really nice opportunity to get them with a nice foreground, and you'll also notice a really nice section of the Milky Way as well. You've got the Carina Nebula here. Just above that you have the Crux constellation and the Dark Coalsack Nebula. And there's a lot of bright stars in this region as well. It's a really nice area of the night sky. This is an image that I took in Chile last year using the star glow filter. Just works really well on all these beautiful bright stars visible from the southern hemisphere. Facing west in the evening skies, you'll notice a trio of planets. So you have Mercury and Mars very low on the horizon, but a lot easier to see than for us in the northern hemisphere. And then of course Venus, much higher and easier to observe. But if I skip forward the dates, you'll notice that on the 18th, it's a really close conjunction between Mars and Mercury. And so as the evening goes on, Mars and Mercury set very early. Really nice opportunity to get a nice zoom shot with a foreground subject there. And Venus, a lot easier to observe in the western skies, shining at magnitude -4. It's the brightest natural object in the night sky after the moon. As darkness falls, you'll notice that the Milky Way core is very high overhead. So if you want to capture the Milky Way core in the evening skies, you'll probably have to do a panorama with a really wide angle lens, like a 14mm. Aim north and just pan your camera up to get a bit of the Milky Way core. The Milky Way core has been chased across the sky by Saturn and Jupiter, both shining at their brightest this month. Saturn reaches opposition on the 2nd of August, and Jupiter reaches opposition on the 19th. So when a planet is in opposition, it's directly opposite Earth from the Sun, so it's the closest we get to that planet, and because it's fully illuminated by the Sun, that's when it's shining at its brightest. But from midnight into the early hours of the morning, you'll notice that the Milky Way core has sunk down to the western horizon, so it's a lot easier to photograph. And if I just come back a little bit, it's a really good opportunity for a Milky Way arch panorama. So facing west, you've got the core at the apex of the arch, and it sort of spans from the south over to the north. So a really, really nice opportunity for a Milky Way arch panorama. If we swing over to the east, you'll notice Pleiades rising into the northeast, and you guys also get a glimpse of Orion returning to the night sky. So signs of the winter constellations on their way. So make the most of the Milky Way core whilst you still can. As for conjunctions and close approaches this month, I've already mentioned Mercury and Mars, but as for the Moon and the planets, the best opportunity comes on the 10th to the 11th, where a very thin crescent moon will be passing by Venus in the western evening skies. And then on the 20th to the 21st, a very nearly full moon will be very close to Saturn and Jupiter, rising in the east after sunset, and then spending most of the night in the sky together. The full moon this month falls on the 22nd, and it was known by Native American tribes as the Sturgeon Moon, as it's the time of year when the sturgeon fish are in abundance. But it's also a blue moon, and there are two definitions to a blue moon. One is the second full moon in a calendar month, or in this case, it's when there are four full moons in a season. Normally, there are three full moons for every season, but every few years, there are four. And the third of the four full moons is known as a blue moon, and it's where the phrase once in a blue moon comes from. As for the special events this month, we have one of the best meteor showers of the year, the Perseid meteor shower. The radiant point of the meteor shower is within the constellation Perseus, which has a declination of +59°. So that means that it's in an area of the night sky that massively favours the northern hemisphere. If you are in the southern hemisphere, try facing north, especially in the morning, the sort of pre-dawn hours. You might have some luck, but this meteor shower is pretty much a northern hemisphere affair. It became active towards the middle of last month, but it doesn't peak until the 12th to the 13th of this month, probably the morning of the 13th. So after the night of the 12th into the morning of the 13th, that's probably going to be the highest rates. Although you can get pretty decent rates in the few days before and a day or two after the peak as well. So it's worth trying your luck as much as you can. Now online you'll find websites telling you that you're going to see 120, 110 meteors per hour. That is the zenithal hourly rate. That is the amount of meteors you would see under perfect conditions, so completely clear skies, bottle class 1 light pollution, and when the radiant point of the meteor shower is in the zenith, the point of sky directly above your head. So be careful, don't get too excited about the sort of hyperinflated expectations of the mainstream media. You're not going to see 120 meteors per hour. I don't mean to be a buzzkill, because it's still one of the best meteor showers of the year. Just try not to get your expectations that high. Fortunately, this year the moon is a waxing crescent during the peak of the meteor shower, so it will be setting in the late evening, and then from midnight to the morning there will be beautifully dark skies, which is perfect because the Perseids is one of those meteor showers that has better activity in the pre-dawn hours, because you'll see more meteors the higher the radiant point gets in the sky. And as the night goes on and as we approach the sunrise, Perseus gets higher and higher and higher and higher, and then the sun starts coming up. So you typically see the most meteors in the pre-dawn hours, and there's not going to be a moon hindering the viewing. It's going to be one of the best years for the Perseids for a while, actually. Perseid meteors tend to be bright, they leave persistent trails. You'll often see vivid colours of green and magenta in the trails in your images, and it makes them really easy to distinguish from satellite trails, which will be sort of white or whitish blue. And if I could offer one last bit of advice, if you're going out to photograph the meteor shower, be careful of lens mist, because during these warm summer nights, temperatures drop very quickly and your lens might become cooler than the dew point temperature and start to mist up, start to fog up. And there's nothing worse than coming back to your camera at the end of a meteor shower to find all of your images are just foggy. So use a lens warmer to keep your lens nice and warm and to prevent that from happening. I'll put a link in the video description down below. But that's all I've got for you this month, guys. Now onto the hashtag Wittens.
For those of you that are new here, every month I set a theme or target subject to photograph and people upload their images to social media using the hashtag Wittens. I then pick my favourite three of the month to win a prize. Third place wins a copy of my Astro Workflow Lightroom presets. Second place wins a What's in the Night Sky t-shirt. And first place wins a photo view photography guidebook of their choice. Last month's theme was Noctilus and Cloud, so it was a bit of an unfair playing field. I'm sorry, but it had to be done. And in third place was Cumbrian Stargazer, with this awesome image of three sheep and a beautiful display of Noctilus and Clouds as the backdrop. And yes, it's the second month in a row I've picked an image with sheep in, and yes, I'm Welsh. You can make all the jokes you want, but this is a really beautiful image. In second place was Tim Pro with this beautiful image, really nice Noctilus and Cloud display, some really interesting patterns, and I love the way that that sort of gothic tower is in between the gap in the trees, really nicely composed, very Lord of the Rings-esque. I really, really loved this image. And in first place was Mads Peter Iverson with this stunning image of a distant lone figure on a hill under an incredible display of Noctilus and Clouds. And I just love the depth you feel in this image. You really get a sense that the Noctilus and Clouds are so far away, even though the distant figure is also so far away. But just a very simple, beautiful image. And Mads uploaded a really awesome vlog about Noctilus and Clouds over on his YouTube channel, so be sure to go and check that out. This month, it's time, guys. It's time for your favorite subject. Let's go with the Milky Way core. It's now easily visible in the south in the evening sky, so no excuses not to catch it. And it's just a really good month to photograph the Milky Way core. So I'm sure we're going to have lots of submissions this month. Anyway, guys, thanks for tuning in to another episode of What's in the Night Sky. Please hit subscribe if you haven't already. And if you're going out to enjoy the night sky anytime soon, I wish you good luck in clear skies.